on both gold, silver, precious metals, even the base metals. And you look at that and you wonder why. Well, the global macro world that we live in is anything but calm. We have so much volatility out there in the world. We've seen, you know, North Korea threatening nuclear weapons. We just had a terrorism incident yesterday in Barcelona. We have incredible political volatility. You see Bannon being fired today out of the White House. Seems like people in the Trump administration can't keep a job longer than a couple months without getting fired. So whether it's the United States, whether it's Europe, whether it's Asia, there's just tremendous global uncertainty. We also have inflation starting to pick its way back up. You have a lot of the central banks around the world that have been printing unlimited amounts of monetary units. So I think investors are really starting to get nervous, starting to get scared, and they're flowing back into precious metals, which offer, you know, real safety and real value. So I think we're going to continue to see these metals do quite well going into this fall.
Definitely. And one of the things that precious metals kind of gives is a little bit of stability. It's a hard asset that you can own, and it's something that has never fallen to zero. I guess, what is your perspective on that? I know, like, with a lot of the political instability and the economic instability right now, a lot of people are looking to precious metals. So what is your perspective on kind of the idea of holding gold and silver as kind of an insurance?
Well, I couldn't agree more. And, you know, Elijah, I'm Swiss. So here in Switzerland, we have always had a culture of precious metals and actually owning physical gold, physical silver, and having it a portion of our portfolios. The Swiss bankers have advised all of the clients for generations, you should have a minimum of 5, but even better, 10% of your entire net worth in precious metals. And a lot of the Swiss have that. But when you look at your average American or European, Asian, most people definitely do not have 10% of their overall net worth in gold or silver. And you rightly pointed out, these are insurance policies. And let's think of insurance. What is the purpose of insurance? You know, most people that drive a car have automobile insurance. And you don't wake up in the morning and say, wow, today's a great day to go out and get in a car crash. I think I'm going to get into an accident today. But the day you do get into an accident, it's really nice to have automobile insurance because it covers the value, the damage to your car. If you hit a person or a building, their car, maybe you have some injuries. And that's when the insurance policy comes into effect. That's what precious metals do for one's net worth and one's portfolio. When we have these major market crashes, when you have fiat currencies that just evaporate due to politicians printing too much money. And we're seeing this in real time right now around the world. If you look at Venezuela and you look at the Venezuelan bolivar, the price vis-a-vis US dollar, it is melting away on a daily basis. So in that sort of environment, if you hold some gold, you hold some silver, what it's going to actually do is maintain your purchasing power parity. These are not instruments that you really want to go out and speculate with, your physical precious metals. These are insurance policies. Buy them, put them away, put them in your sock drawer, keep them, and ultimately it is going to give you real purchasing power down the road.
I know one of the things that a lot of my guests have talked about on my channel is that sometimes, even though, you know, gold and silver seem to hold their purchasing power throughout long periods of time, there can be some points in time where they actually increase in value. And I know you've talked about how you think there's going to be a huge increase in the prices of precious metals. So do you think the price will just increase, or do you think the actual value of precious metals will increase?
I think both. Both the price will increase and the value will increase. And when you look at the price of precious metals, let's look at the price of gold specifically. People look at it and say, oh, the price of gold, $1,300 an ounce, but you know, it's down from the all-time highs. That's true in US dollars. But if you look at the price of gold in many other currencies, whether it's the Mexican peso, you could look at it in the British pound, you could look at it multiple different currencies, the Colombian peso, et cetera, gold is bumping up against all-time highs, Canadian dollar. So the US dollar has been relatively strong only until a couple of months ago. And it really seems like now the US dollar's days are numbered. Tremendous political instability in the United States right now. the market is really starting to question, are any of Trump's policies going to be enacted? Are we going to get health care reform in the United States? Is there going to be tax reform? Is there going to be an infrastructure spending or bill? And all of that really looks to be in doubt. So people are starting to dump the dollar right now. You know, the dollar is really selling off. And as that happens, the price of gold will rise, both in dollar terms and overall relative terms. I think as well, when you look at the mining sector, if we just segue into that a little, you know, there hasn't been major gold discoveries in several years. So the mining sector is actually mining an asset which is quite finite, the amount of gold out there. They're mining it all up. This is getting depleted off of their balance sheets. And all of the gold that's actually been mined in the history of the human race, I mean, it would fit in a little less than two Olympic-sized swimming pools. So we're talking about a very, very, very finite amount of gold. People have asked me before too. They said, well, you know, look how much debt is out there. The price of gold, if it were to actually, if we had to have a per ounce level for the amount of debt, what would it equate to? And a lot of people have done the calculations and they say, well, that could be $10,000, $12,000 an ounce. So it's not unreasonable that the price of these metals could dramatically increase in the future, especially if people lost confidence in one of the world's reserve currencies like the US dollar.
Now, speaking of the mining sector, where do you see the mining sector going in the near future if you see gold and silver increasing significantly?
Look, I think the mining sector is really setting up for some fantastic gains. It's been one of the worst bear markets in history. You talk to people that have been in this industry for 40 years, 50 years, since the 1970s, and they will all tell you, you know, this has been one of the most difficult bear markets that they've been through in their careers. But what's happening? Again, the precious metals are moving up off the bottom. We're seeing $1,300 gold. It's really starting to rise. And when the precious metals price rise, a lot of these mining companies during the bear market, they had to tighten up their balance sheets. They had to reduce their all-in sustaining cash cost. They had to diversify and get rid of high cash cost projects. So they're in much better relative shape right now. And as we move into a new bull market, I think you're going to see these mining companies start to throw off tremendous cash flow. You know, you look at a company like Barrick Gold, two of their biggest mines are just north of our Keystone project. That's their Pipeline mine and their Cortez Hills mine. If you go on Barrick's website and you look at those projects, they have an all-in sustaining cash cost of about $600 an ounce. So with gold at $1,300, you are throwing off tremendous cash flow, $700 an ounce. And I think as a lot of people start getting nervous with the S&P pulling back a little, the Dow pulling back, the NASDAQ pulling back, if some of the money comes out of these high-flying tech stocks and you look at the multiples and valuations and they start looking for real value out there in the markets, I think this money is going to start to flow into the mining sector. And always the metals start to move first, and then the stock prices start to move thereafter. So I think it's real good times ahead.
And for people who are interested in investing in the mining sector, what advantages does the mining sector give as opposed to investing in physical gold and silver?
Well, I think your listeners should certainly have both. You know, you want to have physical gold and silver. You certainly want to have some ounces, but that's your insurance policy. So insurance is not something you go out and you speculate with. You just have it to protect you and your family. Then you start looking at the rest of your portfolio, that other 90%, and where am I going to deploy that capital to increase, you know, my returns, try and get some good relative value? That's when you can start looking at the mining sector. When you start looking at mining stocks, you have your majors, you know, the Barrick Golds, the Newmont, the Anglo Golds, the BHP Billitons, Rio Tinto. These are the big major companies in the sector. You have a tremendous amount of mid-tiers. And then at the bottom, you have the juniors and the exploration companies. That's what we are at US Gold Corp. We're an exploration company. So this is the highest risk sector of the overall gold mining sector. We're not even mining. We're in the exploration sector, which means we're out trying to actually find a deposit on our Keystone property, on our Copper King property. We know there's a deposit. So if we're successful in doing that, if we could prove up a deposit, us or several of these other exploration companies, these can become real lottery tickets. You know, they can move up tremendously, and the major companies ultimately will most likely want to take over small exploration companies that can prove up economic deposits. So it becomes really, really exciting.
Now, can you tell us a little bit more about your company and where do you see it heading in the future?
Yeah, without a doubt. So U.S. Gold Corp., I think we have never been more excited than we are right now about our future. We have three different projects within our company. We have a project in Wyoming called Copper King. Copper King is a more advanced stage property because it already has a defined resource. Copper King has a historic PEA, that's a preliminary economic assessment, that shows a roughly 1.1 million measured, indicated, and inferred gold resource, plus about a 300 million pound measured, indicated, and inferred copper resource. So that's quite robust. And now with copper prices going north of $3, right about there, gold at $1,300, the economics on that project really look exciting. So we're moving that project forward on permitting, and we also believe there's exploration potential at Copper King. Then we have two blue sky exploration projects in Nevada. One is called Keystone. The other one is called Gold Bar North. And both of these properties have been identified and staked by legendary Nevada geologist Dave Mathewson. Dave used to run exploration for Newmont Mining in the Great Basin of Nevada. Dave is a proven ore finder. He has found multiple deposits throughout his career. He has a 50-year career in the exploration sector, 35 years of that in Nevada. And Dave Mathewson believes that Keystone is the best exploration property he has seen in his career. So we are so excited. We drilled on the property last year. We drilled this year. We've done geophysical studies, soil samples, all sorts of technical studies on the property. And Dave Mathewson really believes that Keystone is capable of hosting a major epithermal gold system. Keystone is in big elephant country of Nevada. It's located on the very prolific Cortez Gold Trend. So again, 10 miles south of Barrick Gold's Cortez Hills mine. These are big monster mines. When I talk about Cortez Hills, Pipeline, Gold Rush, ET Blue, these are all major, major mines and discoveries from Barrick. And we're just south of that. We know the geology, the host rocks, everything looks identical to these monster deposits to the north. So we're real excited. We're out there trying to push this project forward and ultimately come with a discovery at Keystone.
All right. Well, before we let you go, I wanted to just wrap back around to the precious metal markets. And one of the things that you said on a recent interview on SGTReport.com was that how the recent rise in cryptocurrencies is kind of foreshadowing the rise that we're going to see in the precious metal markets. Now, I don't want to be putting words in your mouth, but is that your perspective? And can you expand on that?
Yeah, 100%, Elijah. I could not agree more. And I really believe that the rise we're seeing right now in all the cryptocurrencies, from Bitcoin to Ethereum, Dash, Ripple, Litecoin, et cetera, they've all been on an incredible tear. And you look at it and you wonder why. Always in life, you got to follow the money. And who's buying Bitcoin right now over $4,000? You know, who's buying it? Most of the money is coming actually out of Asia, specifically Japan and China. Why? Well, I tell you, the Bank of Japan has absolutely gone insane. They own 2/3 of all the ETFs in the Japanese market right now. They own about 40% of the Japanese government bonds. I mean, the Bank of Japan is just monetizing the entire country. And trust me, this is going to end as a horror film. It is not going to be a comedy. It is not going to end well. I think astute Japanese realize that. And they say, you know what? I would rather have Bitcoin. I'd rather have this digital cryptocurrency that's only been around for a couple of years rather than holding my yen because I don't trust them. Same way in China. In China, we are witnessing the biggest debt bubble in the history of the human race. This makes Bernard Madoff's Ponzi scheme, you know, look like a mosquito. I mean, the Chinese have just taken on so much debt. They have so many zombie countries. Every wealthy Chinese entrepreneur you talk to, all they want to do is get their money out of the country. Reminds me of Russia after the Soviet Union collapsed. And so what are they doing? They're buying Bitcoin, they're buying digital cryptocurrencies, and it's helping them get money out of the country. Then they can go buy their condominium in Vancouver and put their children in Canadian or US schools, which they ultimately want to do. So this is because the Chinese, the Japanese really see their economies and their currencies having problems going forward. And I'm telling you, Elijah, we're going to get to that day in the United States when the average American wakes up and they start to realize that the United States government is bankrupt. The US dollar is doomed. It is going to depreciate massively. And when that starts to happen, I think you're going to have this massive rush into precious metals. I think cryptocurrencies will also continue to do very, very well. And but I really believe that once the big capital comes in, not small mom and pop speculators, but hedge funds, and you look at some of the most successful hedge fund managers out there, Ray Dalio from Bridgewater, he just penned his quarterly letter and said, you know, you should have 5 to 10% of your portfolio in gold. We're starting to see it already. Look what would happen. Imagine if some of the major pension plans in the United States and around the world started to deploy a portion of their assets into gold. Right now in the mining sector, Apple Computer, the market capitalization of Apple, is greater than the entire mining sector. So you have one company, and guess what? You cannot have an iPhone, an iPad, an iPod, any of that without metal. It takes metal to form everything in our lives. So the mining sector is so key and so critical. But the world's just out of whack when one company is greater than the entire capitalization of such a strategic industry like mining. And I think that this will rebalance. Everything tends to revert back to the mean. And when it happens, if we get a big crack in the U.S. equity markets, or we get a big crack in the U.S. dollar, I think it could really bring in a tsunami of capital, and that will just force prices up to the moon. It will be an incredible melt-up, so people need to really start getting their physical gold now. They should be dollar cost averaging each month. Don't even worry about the price. Just worry about how many ounces you ultimately have. Same thing with good mining stocks. You know, develop a diversified portfolio, some of the majors, some of the mid-tiers, some of the junior exploration companies like US Gold Corp for those lottery ticket risk returns. And I think as this bull market starts to develop, you know, all of your listeners will be very, very well positioned.
All right. Well, Edward Carr, thank you so much for joining us today. Before we let you go, did you want to share with the viewers any last thoughts you had and where they can find your company online?
Yeah, our website is a great place to start. So that's www.usgoldcorp.gold. So we put the gold in there twice. And if you go on our website, you can actually sign up for news alerts, additional information, et cetera. And I'd encourage all your listeners, you know, watch the story, sign up for the news alerts, watch our press releases, look at our SEC filings, do your due diligence. You know, if you have any questions, send us an email. We're very responsive. We'll get right back to you. And, you know, we really, really look forward to look how much debt is out there. The price of gold, if it were to actually, if we had to have a per ounce level for the amount of debt, what would it equate to? And a lot of people have done the calculations and they say, well, that could be $10,000, $12,000 an ounce. So it's not unreasonable that the price of these metals could dramatically increase in the future, especially if people lost confidence in one of the world's reserve currencies like the US dollar.
Now, speaking of the mining sector, where do you see the mining sector going in the near future if you see gold and silver increasing significantly?
Look, I think the mining sector is really setting up for some fantastic gains. It's been one of the worst bear markets in history. You talk to people that have been in this industry for 40 years, 50 years, since the 1970s, and they will all tell you, you know, this has been one of the most difficult bear markets that they've been through in their careers. But what's happening? Again, the precious metals are moving up off the bottom. We're seeing $1,300 gold. It's really starting to rise. And when the precious metals price rise, a lot of these mining companies during the bear market, they had to tighten up their balance sheets. They had to reduce their all-in sustaining cash cost. They had to diversify and get rid of high cash cost projects. So they're in much better relative shape right now. And as we move into a new bull market, I think you're going to see these mining companies on both gold, silver, precious metals, even the base metals. And you look at that and you wonder why. Well, the global macro world that we live in is anything but calm. We have so much volatility out there in the world. We've seen, you know, North Korea threatening nuclear weapons. We just had a terrorism incident yesterday in Barcelona. We have incredible political volatility. You see Bannon being fired today out of the White House. Seems like people in the Trump administration can't keep a job longer than a couple months without getting fired. So whether it's the United States, whether it's Europe, whether it's Asia, there's just tremendous global uncertainty. We also have inflation starting to pick its way back up. You have a lot of the central banks around the world that have been printing unlimited amounts of monetary units. So I think investors are really starting to get nervous, starting to get scared, and they're flowing back into precious metals, which offer, you know, real safety and real value. So I think we're going to continue to see these metals do quite well going into this fall.
Definitely. And one of the things that precious metals kind of gives is a little bit of stability. It's a hard asset that you can own, and it's something that has never fallen to zero. I guess, what is your perspective on that? I know, like, with a lot of the political instability and the economic instability right now, a lot of people are looking to precious metals. So what is your perspective on kind of the idea of holding gold and silver?
Pound, you could look at it, multiple different currencies, the Colombian peso, et cetera. Gold is bumping up against all-time highs, Canadian dollar. So the U.S. dollar has been relatively strong only until a couple of months ago. And it really seems like now the U.S. dollar's days are numbered. Tremendous political instability in the United States right now. The market is really starting to question, are any of Trump's policies going to be enacted? Are we going to get health care reform in the United States? Is there going to be tax reform? Is there going to be an infrastructure spending or bill? And all of that really looks to be in doubt. So people are starting to dump the dollar right now. You know, the dollar is really selling off. And as that happens, the price of gold will rise, both in dollar terms and overall relative terms. I think as well, when you look at the mining sector, if we just segue into that a little, you know, there hasn't been major gold discoveries in several years. So the mining sector is actually mining an asset which is quite finite, the amount of gold out there. They're mining it all up. This is getting depleted off of their balance sheets. And all of the gold that's actually been mined in the history of the human race, I mean, it would fit in a little less than two Olympic-sized swimming pools. So we're talking about a very, very, very finite amount of gold. People have asked me before too. They said, well, you know, seeing this in real time right now around the world, if you look at Venezuela and you look at the Venezuelan Bolivar, the price vis-a-vis US dollar, it is melting away on a daily basis. So in that sort of environment, if you hold some gold, you hold some silver, what it's going to actually do is maintain your purchasing power parity. These are not instruments that you really want to go out and speculate with, your physical precious metals. These are insurance policies. Buy them, put them away, put them in your sock drawer, keep them, and ultimately it is going to give you real purchasing power down the road.
I know one of the things that a lot of my guests have talked about on my channel is that sometimes, even though, you know, gold and silver seem to hold their purchasing power throughout long periods of time, there can be some points in time where they actually increase in value. And I know you've talked about how you think there's going to be a huge increase in the prices of precious metals. So do you think the price will just increase, or do you think the actual value of precious metals will increase?
I think both. Both the price will increase and the value will increase. And when you look at the price of precious metals, let's look at the price of gold specifically. People look at it and say, oh, the price of gold, $1,300 an ounce, but you know, it's down from the all-time highs. That's true in US dollars. But if you look at the price of gold in many other currencies, whether it's the Mexican peso, you could look at it in the British
pound. As kind of an insurance.
Well, I couldn't agree more. And, you know, Elijah, I'm Swiss. So here in Switzerland, we have always had a culture of precious metals and actually owning physical gold, physical silver, and having it a portion of our portfolios. The Swiss bankers have advised all of the clients for generations, you should have a minimum of 5, but even better, 10% of your entire net worth in precious metals. And a lot of the Swiss have that. But when you look at your average American or European, Asian, most people definitely do not have 10% of their overall net worth in gold or silver. And you rightly pointed out, these are insurance policies. And let's think of insurance. What is the purpose of insurance? You know, most people that drive a car have automobile insurance. And you don't wake up in the morning and say, wow, today's a great day to go out and get in a car crash. I think I'm going to get into an accident today. But the day you do get into an accident, it's really nice to have automobile insurance because it covers the value, the damage to your car. If you hit a person or a building, their car, maybe you have some injuries. And that's when the insurance policy comes into effect. That's what precious metals do for one's net worth and one's portfolio. When we have these major market crashes, when you have fiat currencies that just evaporate due to politicians printing too much money, and we're